Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. We are so happy that we are joined for this 10th award celebration of the International Children's Peace Prize by our guests of honor. Would you please stand up and give a warm welcome to our guests of honor? And give a warm welcome to our special guests, the winners of the last 9 years. They deserve a warm welcome as well. Okay, have a seat. Welcome, all of you. All be seated. Okay. Your Majesty, Excellencies, guests of honor, ladies and gentlemen, perhaps not all of you have ever been here in this wonderful historic setting, the Ridderzaal, the Hall of Knights, the very heart of Dutch government. And we are here for a very special reason. Last year, Malala Yousafzai from Pakistan received the International Children's Peace Prize. And she received it from Tawakkal Karman. Karman was the youngest Nobel Peace Prize winner then, a place proudly taken over by Malala. So from all of us, congratulations, Malala, I would say. This year again, the prize will be awarded by a Nobel Prize laureate, Archbishop Emeritus Desmond Tutu, who's here as well. Patron of kids' rights, a patron of the International Children's Rights Peace Prize. With this ceremony, we celebrate the 10th anniversary of this wonderful prize. And so we are so happy that the prize winners, almost all of them, the prize winners of the last years are here. Welcome back in The Hague, Peace Prize winners. Welcome to you as well. So this ceremony will be opened by Martin van Rijn. He is the State Secretary in the Netherlands for Welfare, Health and Sports. And Mr. Van Rijn, has agreed to host this event on behalf of the Dutch government. So may I ask an applause for him, Martin van Rijn.
Your Majesty, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to welcome you in the Hall of Knights, a most fitting venue for this special occasion. This building is steeped in history, and through the centuries it has welcomed, since then, very important guests. Today, you are all our very important guests, and I'm extremely proud to be your host. Before I speak to some of you in person, I would like to mention two special anniversaries. It is 10 years since the first International Children's Peace Prize was awarded. And this week, Thursday to be precise, marks the 25th anniversary of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. I think that these are very important milestones. They illustrate that serious attention is being devoted to the right of children and young people. And I welcome this attention, and I shall tell you why. But first, maybe a short lesson in history. As I mentioned, we are in the building with a very rich history. Indeed, history is written here every year on the second Tuesday of September, and that is when our monarch, His Majesty King Willem-Alexander, gives a speech to the throne to open the parliamentary year. And it is in the Hall of Knights that we'd like to honor our national heroes. 2 years ago, on this very spot, our Olympic medalists were invested as knights in the Order of Orange-Nassau. This is a rare distinction given in the recognition of exceptional achievements. And this is what links the Hall of Knights with the International Children's Peace Prize, which is also a very rare distinction given in recognition of exceptional achievements. Each year, it has been awarded by the Dutch organization Kids Rights to a young person who has shown remarkable energy and dedication in promoting children's rights. I wish to congratulate Kids Rights and its president, Mark Dullard, on this special anniversary. I commend you all to this marvelous initiative, which is of course accompanied by a very prestigious prize. However, the prize itself represents a much deeper and very important concept. Kids Rights not only calls attention to children's rights, it actively works to uphold and promote those rights. And as many of you will know, this is an objective which Mr. Dullard also pursues as our National Children's Ombudsman. Looking back over the past 10 years, we can see the results of Kids Rights efforts so far, and what marvelous results they are. There have been 10 worthy winners of Children's Peace Prize, some of whom are with us today. Om Prakash, Tandive, Baruani, Francia, and Keely. Welcome to you all. I'm honored to meet you. You have sent the world an important message. You have shown that young people are willing to stand up for their rights, that they will work to improve their situation, that they set their own objectives, that they devise their own solutions. And more importantly, they put those solutions into practice. And this is built on personal strength, empowerment, and I believe in child participation. And yet I realize that not all young people enjoy the same opportunities in life. Almost 50 million children living in conflict zones do not have access to any education. 120 million children in the world are being exploited as child labor. One every four children is the victim of physical abuse, and these are alarming figures. We cannot stand idly by, we must take action. National governments have a very clear responsibility. They must be aware of children's rights, and they must uphold them. And in this context, I shall follow the Kids' Rights Index with great interest. This is a sort of league table which shows how good countries are observing children's rights. Government action is important, but young people themselves can also take action. They can inspire each other to stand up for their rights. Last year's winner, Malala Yousafzai, did just that. She was recently awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. She shares that honor with Kailash Satyarthi, who will speak to us later. And allow me to offer you my sincere congratulations. Today, a new generation of children and young people makes itself heard. There are three nominees for the Children's Peace Prize 2014, and each is a very courageous and determined young person, responsible for a noteworthy project. But of course, there can be only one winner. A little later yet about the Nobel laureate, Dr. Desmond Tutu, will present the award. Children are entitled to childhood. They must be able to grow up in a safe and healthy environment. They should enjoy every opportunity to develop their full potential. And as I said a few moments ago, I'm a fervent supporter of child participation. but no one can do everything all by themselves. And this is why I so strongly believe in the United Nations Convention on Kids' Rights of the Child. It was signed 25 years ago, a fact that we in the Netherlands are celebrating with the Children's Rights Week. There will be a special summit conference on Thursday, and early next year we shall present our fourth report to the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child in Geneva. Let us remember that it is children themselves whose voices will be heard in Geneva. And it is children themselves whose voices are being heard today in the Hall of Nights. Let me conclude by expressing the hope that all children throughout the world will soon be able to make their voices all heard. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Martin van Rijn, on behalf of Dutch government. ABN AMRO Bank, ladies and gentlemen, has had an integral partnership with the International Children's Peace Prize since 2006. There weren't many people, I think, that thought this prize would become so huge, so prestigious, so powerful. But at ABN AMRO Bank, apparently there were people who thought it would. This idea, initiated by Mark Dullard, I asked him this morning, did you think that it would become so huge and so big? And perhaps you did. I'm not sure. Okay. So, ABN AMRO in the Ridderzaal from 2006. So I think it's good to listen to Miss Caroline Prince, a member of the managing board of ABN AMRO. Give her a warm welcome. Come over, please.
Your Majesty, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, before I continue, I have to tell you that my speech is somewhere in this hall, in the Ridderzaal. So I'm going to start slowly, and I hope that someone will bring the speech to me. Everything was so well organized. And now this. But it allows me to reflect a moment on how I started. Because it is not every day that I have the honor and the opportunity to start with Your Majesty. And then after that, welcome Nobel Prize winners. And welcome Children's Peace Prize winners. You make my day. Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. An applause for her. But I can tell you, thank you. I can tell you that even in my speech, I decided to repeat this opening. Because I truly feel honored and delighted to stand for an audience like this. And your presence here, it shows maybe like nothing else how much importance this prize has gained over the years. And that is not because of us as a sponsor, but it's because of you, right? The children who set an example to the world. And although I say it's not about the sponsors, I can tell you that we are very proud to be associated with the Children's Peace Prize and to be a long-term partner already for Kids' Rights and the Peace Prize. As a society and as a bank, there is a lot we can learn from children. Children who reached out to others around the world. And in doing that, they showed us the true essence of making a difference. I think that's a quality so powerful We need that, especially in this moment in time. Because there is a lot going on in the world. ISIS, Ebola, refugees and poverty around the world, financial instability. Sometimes I ask myself, with all this going on, where do I make the difference? This morning I had the fantastic opportunity to speak, to have a little meeting with the prize winner of today, of this year. It's a young woman, and who's done amazing things from a very young age. And what struck me when I talked with her is that she saw something that touched her. She stood still. She stood up. She came into action. She made a difference. And I asked her, why? Why do you do the things you do? And I think quite honestly, she said, well, in the first instance, she said, I don't know. And then she started laughing and she said, yes, of course, I do know. I do know. I had to. I felt I had to take responsibility for what was happening. And she said, I felt a connection. And that made me realize that I had the power to help. I said, wow. And now she is supporting children, vulnerable kids around the world. Our support to the Children's Peace Prize is a unique way to express our conviction that everyone can make a difference, no matter who you are, where you are, whenever. Everyone can make a difference and make the world a better place. And maybe you can imagine that for us as a bank, this drive is inspiring. We have been through a change process over the past years, and even today. And we expressed our ambition to become a better bank, contributing to a better world. And to make this happen, we invest a lot in our people, in culture, in behavior, in leadership. And key in this process is taking responsibility, is making a difference. And these kids, they are the best role models you could possibly wish for. They show us much better than any book or any training how to do that. To us, these young winners represent the potential that children and young people held. In the years that we have supported Kids' Rights, we have seen and heard their moving stories. And we have seen children who rose above their own situations and stood up to improve the world around them. Now let us be inspired by them. They are true examples of Gandhi's expression, be the change you want to see. They show us how to make a difference, not by using big words, but by doing little things every day. They show us how to be leaders. Who are we not to do the same? Thank you.
Thank you. There is this wonderful English expression, speaking by heart, when you don't need anything on paper. This is a very special award celebration, award ceremony, because it's the 10th International Children's Peace Prize that's being awarded, and we have special speakers. Our next speaker is the founder of the children's rights organization, BBA. He chaired the World March Against Child Labor. And BBA and Kids' Rights have worked for many, many years trying to abolish slavery. Can you imagine? They have supported the liberation of more than 7,000 child slaves, developed more than 20 child-friendly villages. And they have been successful in supporting lawmaking that made child labor in India illegal. Now, this man studied engineering. You're an engineer. But he couldn't close his eyes for the injustice millions of children have to face worldwide and closer at home. So he made his life task of it to eliminate child slavery and child labor. And that has not gone by unnoticed. May I have a very warm welcome for 2040 Nobel Peace Prize winner, because that's you, Mr. Kailash Satyarthi.
My dear children, Your Majesty, Mark, Mr. Minister, Your Excellencies, sisters and brothers. Thank God that I don't have any written paper with me, otherwise. Even you had your written paper, you spoke by heart. When these young people were entering in this room, when you were entering in this room, I was thinking that one powerhouse is good for this beautiful hall and for this beautiful city. But if six powerhouses entering into one hall, what would happen? You are all living powerhouses. You are bringing light to the world. Congratulations. In 2 days' time, we would be celebrating 25th anniversary of Universal Convention on Rights of the Child. But today, we see children die of hunger and malnutrition. Children die because we are not able to provide them very simple medicines. Some children are killed even before they are born. Children are enslaved and sold and bought in lesser prices than the cattle. Children are denied education. Though a lot of progress has been made during these 25 years, but even if one single child is denied childhood, it's a scar on the face of humankind. And we are now talking of millions, rather hundreds of millions. I always say that denial of childhood and denial of freedom is the biggest sin in human history, which is still perpetuating. We are fortunate that we adults were not able to do what the youngsters and children are doing today. The children all across the world, I work in over 100 countries, and I know that children all across the world are standing up for their rights. Their voices cannot remain unheard. Their faces cannot remain unnoticed. Because they are challenging and prepared to change the world. They are not simply icons of hope. They are not simply the propellers of our economies for future. Of course, the young dividend or youth dividend is the biggest propeller of global economy and economies in our countries. But youngsters are the propellers of humanity and morality. The moral deficit in the world is the biggest deficit, I think, in my opinion. The things are growing, economies are growing, but sometimes I see that the personal and social morality is decreasing in many places. And that can be answered and fulfilled by the youngsters in the world if they are given care and protection, respect and friendliness and love and opportunities. Every child is a special child, every child. Every child is born with speciality, with blessings of God. And I always say that when a child is born, the God smiles. God gives a signal that the humanity has to continue and will continue. Every child has enormous potential, and that has to be tapped by the world. We know that education is the key to many child rights and most of the human rights. The world has to spend more on their children, its children, and education for them, health care for them, protection for them, and so that we can tap their biggest possible potential to make this world a better world. I also say, I was talking to a radio interview this morning, and I said that sometimes we as adults believe that we know everything, we can do everything, we are the controllers of everything in the world. It's not true. We keep on teaching our children right from their childhood. We give them fake entities that you are Hindu, you are Muslims, you are Christians, you are Pakistani, you are Indians, you are Africans, you are Latin Americans, you are Asians, etc., Europeans. And these kind of identity and teachings sometimes divide humanity. Child is just a human being, a child. And let us learn from a child. We can learn unity of the world. We can learn simplicity. If you are simple, if you are truthful, if you are honest, if you are helping for others, if you are caring, it's not because you are a very knowledgeable person. It's because a child is in you. And if we keep this child alive, if we keep that child inside each one of us protected, then the world is very beautiful. Look, the world with the child's eye. It's very simple. We make it complicated. Look, the world with child's eye. It's very beautiful. We have to make it. I would once again thank you, Kids Rights. Kids Rights has actually, Mark, you are visionary and very intelligent person. You are bringing all these children as rehearsal for the Nobel Peace Prize. Yeah, be ready for that. This is rehearsal. So what you did this morning was not the rehearsal. This rehearsal is for Oslo, and you have proven through Malala. And the partners of Kids Rights, you knew it before that one day, one by one, are going to become the Nobel laureate, and I'm one of them. So thank you very much for that, for your intelligence. And finally, in one word, I feel more humbled today coming from India. I'm a proud Indian. And the second peace laureate here was Om Prakash from my organization, who was a bonded child laborer, and we freed him, and he's a bright child now in helping others. We have another young lady whom you know in a few minutes. Sometimes I feel that the Indian soil has tremendous potential driven from Gandhiji. Because I am not going to connect with myself, I am going to connect with Mahatma Gandhi, who has been, who has enlightened us and the whole world, and will keep on enlightening his teachings. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, a TV documentary, a film on apartheid in South Africa, inspired a famous singer-songwriter, Labi Sifre, to a song. And especially for this event, a special arrangement was being made by Mike Schaper-Klaus. And we're going to listen to Something Inside So Strong.
No one can stop us. We will speak up for our rights, and we will bring change through our voice.
The higher you build your barriers, the taller I'll become. Father, you take my rights away, the faster I will run. You can deny me, you can decide to turn your face away. No matter comes, there's something inside so strong. Thought if my pride was gone, oh no. But something inside so strong, oh, oh, oh. Something inside so strong.
We are no more, we are human beings.
The more you refuse to hear my voice, of Jericho, your life go down tumbling. Deny my faith in time, you squander well, that's mine. My light will shine so brightly, it will blind you. There's something inside so strong. Know that I can make it, though you're doing me wrong, so wrong. You thought that my pride was gone, oh no. There's something inside so strong, oh, oh, oh. Something inside so strong.
And these young people show the incredible resilience in the human spirit.
Brothers and sisters, when they insist you're not just good enough, when you know better, just look him in the eyes and say, I'm gonna do it anyway. I'm gonna do it anyway. I'm gonna do it anyway. I'm gonna do it. Something inside so strong. something inside so strong. There's something inside so strong. So strong. There's something inside so strong.
Ladies and gentlemen, Noorlaila Karim, André Heuvelman, Michiel Balhaus and Boudewijn Lucas. They were. Okay, here we are for this celebration. And we already saw some of the winners of the last years. And I already told you most of them, most of the winners are here today. So why not come over and join me here on stage? Come over. Om Prakash, Tandive, Barwani, Francia, Kelly, and Cash. Give them an applause. It'll take some time before they are here. Okay, let me interrupt, because otherwise we won't be out of this beautiful hall until it's 6 o'clock, because so remarkable is what you have been doing. Cass, you're the youngest. Can I ask you, what is your most, tell us, your most recent accomplishment of you and your fellow changemakers? Tell us.
Hello. Let me first say that we are all very happy to meet each other and celebrate 10 years of International Children's Peace Prize. The prize offered us children a platform to express our ideas and personal involvement in children's rights. After winning the prize, no one of us stood still. We grabbed the opportunity to use this platform with both hands to improve outward. We did not stop putting in all our efforts to improve children's rights, not at all. For instance, Kaylee has personally helped the South African government to develop the national policy framework for people with disabilities.
I am proud of Kaylee because he has distributed over 30,000 care and hygiene packages to children living on the streets in the Philippines. The number of children you have touched inspires me.
Through his internationally broadcast radio show, Burhani has reunited almost 200 refugee children with their parents after fleeing war. He has helped 30,000 refugee children, their rights and voice out burning issues.
Om Prakat, together with Children's Rights Organization, BBA, has freed hundreds of children from bonded child labor and supported them to go to school.
Francia has helped over 100 children to get a name and nationality so that they can go to school, and that's their right.
Thanks to Tendive, most children in Zambia go to school.
Precisely. Because education is so very important for us children, our dear friend Malala could not be here today. She is the winner of the International Children's Peace Prize of 2013 and the youngest Nobel Peace Prize winner in history. She has no less than 3 exams today as part of her final year in high school. We have spoken to her this weekend and she is ready to rock them today. Because she has to miss out on this very special event, she has asked us to share this video message with everyone here in the Hall of Knights.
First of all, I'd like to say thank you to all of you for giving me this honor to invite me, but I'm really sorry that I can't be there because I have my exams and I want to focus on my education. And as I always say that, I speak up for the education of every child and I want every child to go to school, including myself. So that's why I can't be there. I'm really sorry for that, but I congratulate you on this great success that it is the 10th Jubilee anniversary and it's great, amazing, and I'm hopeful that this work will continue. And I want to say thank you to all of the Children Peace Prize winners and the nominees as well, that you have done a great job for your community, for your countries, and continue this great work, and I will support you, and as well as to the winner of this year, that we appreciate your great work, and I'm hopeful that this will help more and more children to get inspired and to believe in themselves so that they can also help their communities. So once again, thank you to all of you.
Okay. Wonderful to hear from Malala. Wonderful to hear from you, your individual accomplishments. But Kaylee, it doesn't stop there, does it?
Of course not. You never stop being an activist. And we have something important to share with you. We, as International Children's Peace Prize winners, have joined forces in the Youngsters, a unique advocacy platform run by us to realize children's rights around the globe. Too many of us cannot go to school. Too many of us are not healthy. Too many of us cannot live in peace. Whilst progress has been made through the Millennium Development Goals in the last 15 years, not enough has been done. Children's rights need the world's attention, and they need it now. We urge our world leaders to put our rights at the heart of their agendas, nationally and internationally, from the development to the implementation stages. We want to work together. We know best what we need in order to live happy, healthy, safe, and fulfilling lives. We have lived through the challenges. I know how it feels to be discriminated against. Bahrani knows how it feels to be forced to flee your country. Whatever challenges children face, we want everyone to acknowledge that they can be change makers, that we can all move the world.
Okay. So you are bundling your forces. What will be your first action?
Tomorrow in London, in the presence of 450 human rights experts spanning 40 countries, we will stand up against child slavery. Om Prakash will share his story, and we urge governments to take action. We have some epic plans for 2015. From the United Nations to our home countries and own communities, we will increase our actions to make sure that children co-decide on the matters that affect their lives.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. So Kids Rights Youngsters, that's who they are. Thank you. Thank you once again. And follow them online and give them your support. The Peace Prize winners, ladies and gentlemen. These courageous. And once again, Desmond Tutu is applauding for them. Great. Yeah. It's amazing to think it's only 10 years ago that this prize came to us. And we all know that little boy, don't we? Nkosi Johnson. And with the prize comes this statuette. It's called the Nkosi. It's been named after him, this courageous South African boy who stood up and fought for the rights of children with HIV/AIDS. And we are so very happy that his foster mother, Gail Johnson, is here. You are here as well, yes. Thank you for being here. Yeah, that's right. It's so good of you to be here because Nkosi was the first one who had been awarded this International Children's Peace Prize posthumously. Unfortunately, he can't be here, but we're happy that you are here. So, in order to make a tribute to him, let us stand up and listen to South Africa's national anthem.
Nkosi sikelele iAfrika, maluphakanyisa uphondo lwayo, izwa imithandazo yethu, Nkosi sikelela. Sapolayo Morena Moloka si chava sa Yesu Ufe di sedin twali matswine
Ladies and gentlemen, yeah. It's an emotional moment here. Hope Maine, yeah, Hope Maine, the applause was also for you, star of London West End at this very moment. And of course, your applause for the Rotterdam Symphony Chorus. For them all. Okay, let's be seated. And let us have a look at some of the achievements of these amazing young people over here in the last past 9 years. Let us have a look.
Hey, you oldies, listen to the children. listen to your children. Listen and act.
The International Children's Peace Prize is an initiative of the Dutch Kids' Rights Foundation. Every year, this prize is awarded to a child who bravely fights for children's rights anywhere in the world. In 2005, the first Children's Peace Prize was posthumously dedicated to Nkosi. During his short life, he pleaded for the rights of HIV and AIDS-infected children.
We are normal. We are human beings.
The next year, former child slave Om Prakash received the prize for his unceasing work to combat child labor and liberate child slaves in India. Tandiwe from Zambia won the prize in 2007 because of her extraordinary effort for the right to education for all children. Maíra battles against violence in Vila Cruzeiro in Brazil. She was therefore awarded with the fourth International Children's Peace Prize. Baruani from DR of Congo won the prize for his work promoting children's rights in the refugee camp in Tanzania where he lives. In 2010, Francia received the prize. She campaigns for the right to name and nationality of children in the Dominican Republic. Kaylee won the prize for her commitment to the rights of children with disabilities in South Africa.
That disabled people can't physically voice what they need and what they deserve. And I can.
Africa, Malo Paganyesu, Ondolwayo.
Desmond Tutu, patron of Kids' Rights and the International Children's Peace Prize, honored the winner of 2012. Kez received the prize for helping street children in the Philippines. In 2013, the prize was awarded to 16-year-old children's rights activist Malala from the Swat Valley in Pakistan, who fights for girl empowerment through education. The Children's Peace Prize is not only a sign of recognition for these young winners. Kids' Rights offers them a platform to promote their message, reaching hundreds of millions of people worldwide. They set a great example of how children can move the world.
No one can stop us. We will speak up for our rights, and we will bring change through our voice.
As I mentioned before, the importance of this prize has increased enormously. So every year, the message of one of these young people reaches millions of people. Now, there is this fund, the Axo Nobel Children's Peace Fund, 100,000 euros. And Kids' Rights has invested that money over the last 9 years in several projects closely linked to the focus of each winner, the focus of children's rights that year. So, more than 70,000 children have been reached by these projects. So I think it's time to listen to the man who founded Kids' Rights, who initiated the International Children's Peace Prize, who since 2011 is Kinderombudsman, Children's Ombudsman here in the Netherlands. So when he says something, we listen always very carefully, as I'm sure that you will do now. Mark Dullard, come over, please.
Your Majesty, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, as you heard, the past 10 years, Kids' Rights has helped more than 100,000 children, of which the Children's Peace Prize Project Fund helped more than 70,000 children. The message of the Children's Peace Prize winners reached and inspired hundreds of millions of people around the world. I think we can be proud of this. And therefore, from the bottom of my heart, I would like to thank all the people who made this possible, who have helped in so many ways. First of all, I'd like to thank our Children's Peace Prize winners, our patron Desmond Tutu, the Nobel Peace Laureates, our project partners, our donors, our sponsors, the ABN AMRO Bank, our ambassadors, our volunteers, and of course the Kids' Rights team, our board, and our families. Look at you, you're all here in the Hall of Knights, in the Ridderzaal. Thank you very, very much. Give them a big hand. This year, we received 46 qualified candidates from 25 countries all over the world. And I would like to introduce you the three nominees for the International Children's Peace Prize 2014. The first nominee is Andrew, a 13 years old boy from Ghana, and at age 11 he saw horrid images of starving children on television in Somalia. He started his own one-man action, and with his message, he raised nationwide attention for the hungry in the Horn of Africa. The other nominee is 17 years old Alexei from Russia. Alexei is openly gay and knows how badly young people need his support in Russia. Alexei has become the face of the fight against discrimination of homosexual young people in his country. The third nominee is Neha Gupta from the United States of America. When she was 9 years old, she started her own organization, and since then has helped more than 25,000 children, both in India and in the United States, and mobilized many children all over the world to join her. Ladies and gentlemen, these nominees, the winner of today and the winners of the past 10 years, have one thing in common. They have something inside so strong. We just heard the song this afternoon, and it says, "The more you refuse to hear my voice, the louder I will sing. You can deny me, you can decide to turn your face away. The further you take my rights, the faster I will run, because something inside so strong." Ladies and gentlemen, these children dare to listen to their inner voice, to their conscience, and then act and start to change things. It's a compassionate action for change. In fact, they are the change. We, as adults, who often think that only governments or the UN can make changes, and that we have no part in this process. We often think as adults that we are separated from the world, but we are the world. We are the cause of things that happen. Change starts with yourself. We must go back to ourselves and listen carefully. What can I do? What do I have to offer? Change is not an abstract thing. It's very close by. You can start it in your own community, in your own school, in your own street, in your mind. The Children's Peace Prize winners are change makers. They stand up and help other children to take their own lives in their hands. being proud of themselves. It's a renewed pride of children. It's a new way of thinking. They stop spiritual poverty. They fortify the weak. Children are not second-hand citizens. Today, the individual Children's Peace Prize winners unite in a group, and they call themselves, as you heard, the youngsters. And they make an appeal for change. Change for each and every child slave. Change for each and every street child. Change for each and every refugee child. It's an appeal for children that deserve a chance as we have had once. So the youngsters dare to challenge us to be part of this journey, a journey of change that starts here and ends up here. The history of the past 10 years, of the courage to listen to something inside so strong, and of being the change yourself, is now collected in a book, launched here today in the Netherlands, and tomorrow worldwide. It will be translated in many, many languages, also in Urdu for Pakistan. It was a special request from Malala. But I think this book, with all these stories, is the most precious thing these young winners can give us. Their incredible stories. And they want you to spread their words. Spread them to inspire us all to become change makers. And as the Children's Peace Prize statuette expresses, then we will really move the world together. Thank you.
Okay, and now the Peace Prize winners will offer this book to our guests of honor. Okay. A book for everyone. Change makers. Okay. Well, do not read now, because now is the most exciting part of this event. So we know who the nominees are. So now I'm giving you over to our guest of honor, because he is going to announce who the winner is. And I mentioned him before. Need I say more? Desmond Tutu, I've got all kinds of lines here, social, moral conscience of South Africa, of course. A wise man, we know you are, Mr. Tutu. You are a frolic man, we laughed this morning. Would you please come over? Desmond Tutu, give him a warm applause.
Thank you, Grandpa. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Are you comfortable? Okay. Okay.
Your Majesty, Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, very dear Nobel colleague, and you splendid former winners of this International Children's Peace Prize. Ladies and gentlemen, I mustn't think this is a pulpit, yeah? That I should think I have to preach a sermon. After Nelson Mandela died, they had some beautiful cartoons. One of them showed Nelson Mandela arriving in heaven, and St. Peter comes out and takes out his cell phone because he wanted to do a selfie with Madiba. We have already been told this is a very significant year. It is the 10th anniversary. And I think we haven't done so, but we ought to give a very warm applause to Mark and the people who have supported this particular children's prize. I think you've got to give him a very warm clap, yes. You know what? I don't think you gave him a nice clap. I think we should stand and just show how thrilled we are. Thank you. Thank you. Congratulations. And I think we want to give a very warm hand to Amro Bank for having supported, even if they miss, they lose their speeches. Wonderfully, they don't lose the money. thank goodness. I mentioned Nelson Mandela. He had a particular love and devotion to young people, children, and invested a lot of his Peace Prize money to start up the Nelson Mandela Children's Fund. Well, actually, you know, he was showing the same kind of appreciation for young people that God has. You know? You remember when
there was a famine and the people were going to starve. It was the last born, Joseph, who saved his people. And then much later, when they were being oppressed by the Philistines, again, it was the last born of the family, David, who rescued his people by killing the giant. I could go on like that, but maybe the next one is, do you remember Jeremiah? God says to Jeremiah, hey, Jeremiah, and he says, yes. I want you to be a prophet. Jeremiah, no, please, sorry. God, sorry. I'm young, I'm too young. And God says to him, God tells him something that is wonderful for each one of us. God says to him, you know what? Long before you were born, I knew you. Isn't that fantastic? That each one of us is not an afterthought. Fantastic. We are not an afterthought. We are not an accident. Some of us might look like accidents. None of us is an accident. None of us. And we could go on in that fashion to show just how God seemed to have this bias for young people. You remember? Knock, knock. Who's there? Gabriel. Gabriel who? Gabriel the archangel. Come in. Hello, Mary. Hello. Mary. Yes. God wants you to be the mother of God's son. Imagine if she had said, what? You know, in this village, you can't scratch yourself without people knowing about it. You want me to be what? An unmarried mother? No, sorry, I'm a decent girl, try next door. Fortunately for us, Mary said, behold the handmaid of the Lord, and the whole universe sighed a cosmic sigh of relief. And you know, Mary's son died at 30. That young man on the cross, whom most of us regard as our savior, was a young person. And so you would say about Francis of Assisi, and you go on and on and on, and now we have a new edition of these splendid creatures that God says to us, listen to these young people. Listen. And if we were to begin to do the things that they say, we would have a different world. They speak about
ending war. Aren't they fantastic? They dream of a world where war is no more. They dream of a world where poverty is history. They dream like God's dreaming. God dreaming and saying, when will my children know that they belong in one family? When will they know this? When will they know that they, how could they possibly spend so much money on arms when a very, very small fraction would enable children everywhere in the world to have enough food to eat, to have educate, protection, homes, would have decent schools. Children would grow because they were playing. There are places where children can't go and play. They go out and they step on a mine and they are blown up. And you know, God says, please, listen when they speak about caring. Please listen to them as they speak about compassion and gentleness and caring and sharing. Please listen. Please make our earth a happy home for children. It'll be a happy home for us as well. Please listen. They're going to show a video of, I don't know who this year's winner is, but I gather they are going to show the video.
Every child deserves a right to have a chance at life, to be successful, to become confident, to grow into people who they can be proud of.
Neha Gupta is an 18-year-old American girl whose family comes from India. Her story starts when she is 9 years old on an annual visit to her grandparents and becomes friends with a girl from the local orphanage. Her friend, who seemed to have so much in common with her, had no chance of an education and lacked the love and support Neha had enjoyed from the moment she was born. It was then that she suddenly realized what it truly means to have absolutely nothing.
I realized that that was a reality for all the children at the orphanage, and I wanted to be able to help them with that. I wanted to aid them.
Neha knew her empathy would not be enough. She really needed to do something. Back home in the United States, Neha started her first garage sale fundraiser. A year later, she returned to India with $5,000 to fund a library, food, clothes, and blankets and shoes for the children of the orphanage. And so, her organization, Empower Orphans, was born, and they achieved great things. Not only in India, but also in her own country. As Neha grew older, she saw that there were American children in her own region also desperately in need of help. Here in these streets of Philadelphia, the lives of underprivileged children can be hard and educational opportunities are limited. It's in these areas that Empower Orphans also provides a beacon of hope. Like at Feltonville Intermediate School, Neha donated a library, a place for children to be safe and broaden their horizons.
Creating that environment itself, not just the books, but also creating the environment that says that this is a comfortable and a safe place to be, could not have happened without her help.
Here, a book is much more than a simple gift. For many of these children, a book is something very special. For the kids in this school, Neha is not only someone who provides books, but she also inspires the children to think about what they can do to help other vulnerable children.
Yes? I would go to that hospital that the little kids are having cancer and stuff, and give them, like, letters or with the lollipop.
Although Neha is now in college, she's still running her foundation with full force, and she is expanding her activities in India and the US to a global level. In 9 years, Neha has raised over $1.3 million and assisted more than 25,000 children.
I want to tell youth that don't become discouraged thinking that the world is too large to change. It is very large, but if we start small with impacting individual lives, that can ripple out further.
Her work has inspired youth all over the world to take action. They have started with their own projects and assist Neha in her work. And it works. Children are empowering other children. Neha has already mobilized over 1,000 children and youth all over the world.
It's our responsibility to help other people, to ignite change, and to be the ones to help the other children of the world, whether they're terminally ill or impoverished. It's our responsibility.
Neha proves that children can be change makers and that they really can make things happen. Already, 25,000 children will never ever forget that.
My message to the world is to convert empathy into action and make a difference in other people's lives.
In moving others, she moves the world. And that is why Neha is the rightful winner of the International Children's Peace Prize 2014.
Before moving to the actual presentation of the award, let me read to you the expert committee's report selecting the 2014 International Children's Peace Prize winner. And it reads, the expert committee of the International Children's Peace Prize applauds Neha for assisting so many vulnerable children from such a young age, and by doing so, inspiring thousands of children worldwide to participate in making the world a better place. Neha has shown from a very young age that children can stand up for a more equal and just world. She has shown that it doesn't matter where you are from, we're all able to make a difference. Through her work and her network of young change makers, Neha exemplifies the essence of the International Children's Peace Prize. Together, they move the world in a most encouraging manner. It is the hope and the expectation of the expert committee that the 2014 International Children's Peace Prize will give Neha a worldwide podium for her views and actions, and that she will continue to inspire children all over the world to fight for their rights. Therefore, the expert committee of the International Children's Peace Prize has decided to award the 2014 Children's Peace Prize to Neha Gupta. Congratulations, Nea. Just hold it that way, and I'll just stand next to you. It's yours. It's heavy.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The floor is yours. Thank you.
I'm going to go back now. You want to put it back there? Yes.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen.
It's almost an impossible question for the colleagues of the press, because they want to have their photo momentum. Yeah. Het photo moment, that's called in Dutch. They all want to have a picture of you, but they all have now. Okay, may I have one more applause for the winner of the International Children's Peace Prize, Neha Gupta. May I invite you for your speech?
Your Majesty, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Thank you, Bishop Desmond Tutu, for your kind words and for allowing me to share this stage with you. Words cannot express how honored I am to receive the International Children's Peace Prize. I accept it on behalf of all children who strive to make a difference in the lives of others. To each of the previous International Peace Prize, Children's Peace Prize winners, I am humbled and so excited to be in your company. To everyone at Kids' Rights, thank you for providing me with the opportunity. I really never imagined to be standing on this stage. What an incredible journey it has been from the first steps I took into the Balkhunj orphanage in India. It has now been 9 years since I began Empower Orphans, since my perspective on life completely changed. Before my journey began, I was a typical child growing up in the West. Like many of my peers, I was accustomed to all the privileges with which I had been born: a warm and secure house, plenty of food to eat, the ability to attend school, access to a doctor if I got sick, and most importantly, the unconditional love of my family. These were a given in my eyes, and they were the norm because everyone around me had the same. That is not to say, though, that I was not aware of the terrible poverty. Having visited family in India on numerous occasions throughout my childhood, I had seen children on the street begging for food, and my heart would break for them in the moment, but I really felt powerless to help them, and eventually I would return home to the United States and continue with my life as usual. All of that changed one day when I was 9 years old. While staying with my grandparents in India, we made our traditional visit to the local Balkhunj orphanage. Although I had been there several times before, something happened on this occasion that changed my life forever. I made a connection. On that day, I became friends with Gayathri, a girl from the orphanage, and it was through this friendship that I understood for the first time what it truly meant to have nothing. On that day, I met Gayathri. A group of girls from the orphanage was teasing her because she did not know her own birthday. I was shocked. For a 9-year-old growing up in the West, A birthday is one of the most anticipated times of the year, a time for gifts and celebration. I realized that something I treasured so dearly might not be available to all children. What seemed minuscule, but actually crucial at that age, made me understand the stark differences between our lives. And suddenly, it was clear to me what it really meant to be poor in the truest sense, to have no one to give you absolute love and no place to call home. For the first time, I considered the implications of these children's realities, not being able to go to school or receive medical attention. The futures that likely awaited these children terrified me. In that moment, I knew I had to take action to help these children have hope. I had to find my voice so that they could have one too. And thus, Empower Orphans was born. When I came back to the United States, I began to organize fundraisers for the orphans. My plan was simple: to help the children escape the shackles of poverty through better education and healthcare. As I grew up, though, and matured, I realized that this was a dream I could not achieve on my own. And thus, my goals for Empower Orphans evolved to include educating other young people and uniting them for the purpose of empowering disadvantaged children. My experience has made me appreciate the power of a ripple effect. Imagine throwing a pebble into a pond. The first ripple is small, but then you watch in awe as the ripples become larger and larger. And just so is the impact of one person with an idea or a mission that speaks to the heart. Over the years, hundreds of other youth have joined me in supporting Empower Orphans. One example is the story of Rushiel, a 9-year-old boy who had to complete a school project about heroes. I was brought to tears when I learned that instead of selecting Superman or Batman, he actually chose me. And beyond sharing the good work of Empower Orphans, this boy took his efforts even further by convincing his classmates to raise money to buy 3 goats for a family in need in Africa. My young friend's beautiful example not only impacted his school and friends in a lasting way, but also a family on another continent. Reflecting on the impact of Empower Orphans, I realize how much it has also influenced the person that I am becoming. One of my favorite sayings is, "Throw your heart out in front of you and run ahead to catch it." I realize that although I'm still young, I have been chasing my heart for many years now. I have found my passion, which is giving hope to others and surfacing the beauty within them, enabling them to rise from their struggles. Now, I will throw my heart out even further as I study to become a pediatric doctor, pursuing my passion for service through the power of healing. Youth around the world, no matter what your passion might be, this is our time to stand up and let our voices be heard. It is our time to be the igniters of change. Find a cause that touches your heart, convert your empathy into action, and then let those actions ripple out. Be an unstoppable force for good that reaches your friends, your community, and your world. I extend to you all an invitation to engage in the world, to make a difference in the lives of the kids who are sick and in need of care, who have to fight for their educational rights, who simply need our love. Not only will your actions make a difference in someone else's life, but it will also enrich your own. Together, we can bring about real and lasting change and create a world in which each life is made whole, full of promise, hope, and compassion for others. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, yeah, who am I to interrupt your applause? I say it once again, Nia Rupta, the winner of the International Child Rights Prize 2014. It's up to you.
Love.
Mooi. Ladies and gentlemen, this is how you celebrate an anniversary, isn't it? So, I will give you their names. The Rotterdam Philharmonic Orchestra, the Codarts World Orchestra, on piano Michiel Balhaus, the Rotterdam Symphony Chorus, the Gospel Choir Babette Labai with Luc Maria, Nika and Bo, Kelvin Mewis, conductor, and a special applause also for Mike Schaperklaus, musical director of this afternoon's program. Now, I'm going to ask you to leave. Yes, that's going to happen. Thank you very much, all of you, for being here. Thank you, speakers. Thank you, you have participated in such a wonderful ceremony. May I invite the winners to join His Majesty the King in the Rolzaal upstairs. Come over here and join Our Majesty the King. They will. Okay. We give you an applause, a warm applause. Okay. I do have another announcement to make. That's for members of the accredited press. You may go up in a few minutes for the photo moment. Yeah, there goes the statuette. So go with it in a few minutes. You can take some photos. And to all of you, I say you can leave when the youngsters are gone over there. Don't leave The Hague if you are planning to, because there is a reception in Societeit de Witte. And I thank you for your attention for this wonderful event. Thank you. Thank you very much.